Atrial fibrillation with slow ventricular rate. In this ECG, fine fibrillary waves are seen throughout the baseline indicating fine atrial fibrillation. When the fibrillary waves are more than 1 mm in amplitude, they can be considered as coarse atrial fibrillation. Coarse atrial fibrillation usually indicates larger reentrant circuits and hence larger atria. Coarse atrial fibrillation is classically seen in mitral stenosis with large left atrium. In this case with fine atrial fibrillary waves, the ventricular rate is not high as in usual atrial fibrillation in which ventricular rates are over 120 per minute. The QRS complexes are narrow and there is slight rightward deviation of axis with small negative complexes in AVL. Tall R waves are noted in V5 and poor R waves in V1 and V2. There is no significant ST segment or T wave abnormality. Slow ventricular rate in AF indicates that the atrial fibrillary signals are mostly blocked at the AV node and prevented from being conducted to the ventricles. This can happen if the AV node is diseased due to ischemia or degenerative disease. In acute inferior wall myocardial infarction, AF is often associated with slow ventricular rate due to ischemia of the AV node, which often recovers after the acute phase. But the AF also disappears by that time. Another situation for slow ventricular rate in AF is with six sinus syndrome having structural nodal disease of binodal variety. Slow ventricular rate in AF can occur if the AV node is suppressed by drugs like digoxin, beta blockers, or non-dihydropyridine calcium channel blockers like verapamil or diltiazem. Discussion on short run of ventricular tachycardia and atrial fibrillation. Underlying rhythm is atrial fibrillation as there are no P waves and it is an irregular rhythm. Short run of wide QRS tachycardia should be considered as run of ventricular tachycardia. Alternate possibility is Ashman phenomenon and concealed transseptal conduction maintaining aberrancy. But the short run is much faster than the basic ventricular rate of the atrial fibrillation. Yet a long short sequence as in Ashman phenomenon is evident at the onset with cycle lengths of 480 and 320 milliseconds. Moreover, the cycle length of the tachycardia beats is almost constant at 320 milliseconds. Cycle lengths would have been irregular if it was Ashman phenomenon and concealed transseptal conduction. The pause of 600 milliseconds after termination of the tachycardia is also in favor of ventricular ectopic activity causing a ventricular tachycardia. The pause can be considered like a full compensatory pause, which is not part of the Fish criteria for Ashman phenomenon. One possibility to be considered when a run of ventricular tachycardia occurs in the setting of atrial fibrillation is digoxin toxicity. Digoxin is still being used for control of ventricular rate in atrial fibrillation, though its use has come down much compared to yesteryears when it was the sheet anchor of treatments. One would expect some STT changes, that is reverse correction mark sign, in the baseline rhythm in case of digoxin toxicity, which is not seen here. Moreover, the ventricular rate of atrial fibrillation is not that slow as we expect when toxic levels of digoxin are present. But these are not absolute criteria which can confidently rule out digoxin toxicity as a cause in this case. Other possibilities for increased myocardial irritability like electrolyte imbalance and myocardial ischemia are more likely for this type of rhythm on the monitor in the current scenario. Discussion on causes of regular RR interval in atrial fibrillation. ECG in atrial fibrillation is characterized by absent P waves, presence of fibrillary waves or F waves, and a totally irregular RR interval. But regular RR interval in atrial fibrillation can occur if there is associated 1. Complete AV block, 2. Ventricular tachycardia, 3. AV junctional tachycardia, 4. AV nodal ablation followed by permanent pacemaker implantation. In all these conditions, regular RR interval in atrial fibrillation occurs because the ventricles are controlled by a different rhythm, not dependent on the irregularly conducted atrial signals of atrial fibrillation. AV node ablation with permanent ventricular pacemaker implantation is usually considered when the ventricular rate in AF is high despite optimal medications. In one study, significant improvement in left ventricular ejection fraction, quality of life and activity scores was documented after discontinuing rate controlling medications, AV node ablation and pacemaker implantation. The ablate and pace trial also had documented similar improvements. Sometimes there can be an apparent regularity when the ventricular rate in atrial fibrillation is low, as those on digoxin or beta blockers, but close scrutiny will reveal the subtle irregularity in RR intervals. Digoxin toxicity can cause complete heart block and regular RR intervals due to the subsidiary pacemaker in atrial fibrillation. Atrial fibrillation with paroxysmal AV junctional tachycardia can also cause complete AV dissociation and regular ventricular rhythm in digoxin toxicity. Discussion on Ashman phenomenon in atrial fibrillation. Ashman phenomenon is a form of aberrancy which was described in 1947. It is aberrancy due to the change in refractory period with varying cycle length. The refractory period increases with increase in preceding cycle length and vice versa. Hence, if a short cycle follows a long cycle, aberrancy can result. The aberrancy is usually of right bundled branch type because refractory period of right bundle is more than that of left bundle branch. Aberrancy can be maintained in subsequent beats due to a concealed transseptal conduction which keeps the right bundle branch refractory. This rather fast sequence of wide QRS complexes in the setting of atrial fibrillation mimic a runoff ventricular tachycardia. But the differentiating features are the initiating long-short sequence and the irregularity in RR interval during the tachycardia. Recognition of Ashman phenomenon in a strip of AF can be clinically important. If the person is on digoxin, occurrence of Ashman phenomenon does not call for dose reduction. But if it is ventricular ectopy, dose reduction is needed as it could be due to digoxin toxicity. Same applies in a more sinister way to a run of wide QRS complex tachycardia. Fish has proposed a few criteria for the diagnosis of Ashman phenomenon. 1. Long short sequence terminating in the wide QRS. Occasionally, a reverse sequence has also been reported. Though RBBB aberrancy is more common, LBBB aberrancy can also occur. 2. RBBB aberrancy as a normal initial QRS vector. 3. Varying coupling intervals of the aberrant QRS complexes. 4. Full compensatory pause is not seen as the underlying rhythm is atrial fibrillation. Richard Ashman was a physiologist at Louisiana State University School of Medicine in New Orleans. Holiday heart syndrome is the name given to atrial fibrillation which occurs after binge drinking. The original description was in 1978 by Ettinger and Associates. This study reported 32 arrhythmic episodes in 24 patients. There was spontaneous recovery with abstinence from alcohol. Holiday heart syndrome should be considered in the differential diagnosis of new onset atrial fibrillation in those without structural heart disease. In one study, alcohol was thought to be the causative agent for 35% cases of new-onset atrial fibrillation. The amount of alcohol needed to precipitate it is variable. Greenspun and Associates evaluated 14 patients with history of rhythm disturbances and alcohol consumption. They could induce atrial or ventricular tachyarrhythmias in 10 of them with programmed stimulation after intake of alcohol while only two had it before the intake of alcohol. Significant prolongation of HV interval was also noted. A case of cardiac arrest after an alcohol binge has also been reported in literature. Ventricular fibrillation was documented and successfully resuscitated. Dual AV nodal pathways were documented on EP study. AV nodal effective refractory period was 210 milliseconds, so that on induction of atrial fibrillation, fast ventricular response and hemodynamic collapse occurred. Radio frequency catheter modification of the AV node was done, and he had no recurrence after abstaining from alcohol. Though atrial fibrillation in holiday heart syndrome usually reverts on withholding alcohol, one report documented no relief after 4 days and required electrical cardioversion for reversion to sinus rhythm. An updated review on the data compiled 34 years after the original description of holiday heart syndrome has been published by David Tonillo and colleagues. Adenosine is widely used in the termination of supraventricular tachycardia. One of the initial reports of atrial fibrillation induced by adenosine was by Silverman and Associates in 1996. They described 5 patients who developed AF after adenosine administration. None of these patients had structural heart disease and only one had prior history of AF. Adenosine was given during electrophysiological study in these patients with SVT to block AV conduction to unmask any potential axillary pathway. Please subscribe to this channel for future updates. Click on the subscribe button. Press the bell icon after that for all updates. Hence, the administration was during sinus rhythm and not during SVT. 4 of them developed AV block prior to AF, while the remaining patient had axillary pathway conduction. They propose that the shortening of atrial action potential by the action of adenosine on its receptors in atrial myocytes is the mechanism for induction of AF. They also highlighted the potential risk of AF with fast ventricular rate in case it is precipitated while treating SVT mediated by an accessory pathway. Prior to this report, Belhassen and Associates had reported induction of AF by ATP. Strickberger and colleagues noted 12% incidence of AF when 12 mg adenosine was given through the femoral vein for SVT during an EP study. The mean ventricular response in AF was similar in this study for those with AVNRT and AVRT and was modest. The maximum pre-excited heart rate was 214 per minute. They proposed that shortening of atrial action potential duration is a possible mechanism for induction of AF. In addition, they noted frequent atrial ectopics, which would have contributed to precipitation of AF by the long shot sequence mechanism. Adenosine-induced AF has been reported by Israel and colleagues as well. Lee and Associates used optical mapping and immunoblot mapping of atria to evaluate the mechanism of adenosine-induced AF in explanted human hearts. They noted higher A1 receptor expression in right atria. G protein coupled inwardly rectifying potassium channels activated by A1 receptors were considered to be involved in maintaining reentrant drivers in lateral part of right atrium. Discussion on postoperative AF after cardiac surgery. Postoperative AF is one of the most common complications after cardiac surgery. The occurrence of postoperative AF is rising as more and more older patients are undergoing cardiac surgery. It may occur in up to 1/3 of post-cardiac surgical patients. Several trials have evaluated postoperative AF and many meta-analyses have been conducted on these trials. AF can occur both after coronary artery bypass graft surgery and surgery for valvular heart disease. The onset of AF would mean longer stay in the intensive care unit and higher risk of postoperative stroke. The risk of stroke is enhanced 2 to 4 times with postoperative AF. In addition, there is a chance for delirium and cognitive dysfunction in these cases. Postoperative AF after coronary artery bypass graft surgery has been associated with both higher in-hospital and long-term mortality. The study compared 994 patients who developed post-CABG AF and 5,481 who did not develop AF. Survival at 5 years was 87% in those who had postoperative AF, while it was 93% in those who did not have AF. Several strategies have been employed in the prevention and treatment of postoperative AF. They include beta blockers, magnesium, sortilol, amiodarone, calcium channel blockers, digoxin, and atrial overdrive pacing. Of the lot, digoxin appears to have least evidence in favor of it. Use of digoxin for prophylaxis against AF is a class 3 recommendation as per 2014 AATS guidelines, that is, not to be used for prophylaxis. Beta blocker withdrawal may increase the risk of postoperative AF. Continuation of beta blockers is a class 1 recommendation in 2014 AATS guidelines. Sortilol appears to be more effective than conventional beta blockers in some studies. Various forms of atrial pacing used in the prevention of postoperative AF are right atrial pacing, biatrial pacing, left atrial pacing, and Backman's bundle pacing. Several trials have evaluated the role of pacing, but the overall results have not been very encouraging, though there was mild reduction in the incidence of postoperative AF. Amiodarone has been evaluated in several trials with fair results. 2014 AATS guidelines gave a class 2A recommendation for the use of amiodarone in postoperative AF. They advise caution while selecting doses for intravenous or oral route because cases of ARDS had been reported following pneumonectomy with cumulative intravenous doses above 2150 mg. Emergency synchronized cardioversion is needed in postoperative AF with hemodynamic instability. That is a class 1 recommendation. Beta blockers and non-dihydropyridine calcium channel blockers like diltiazem have a class 1 indication for rate control in postoperative AF. Caution is advised in those with left ventricular dysfunction, heart failure, or hypotension. Intravenous amiodarone has a class 2A recommendation in these situations. Amiodarone has a potential for converting AF to sinus rhythm. Hence, if it is initiated after 48 hours of onset of AF, transesophageal echo to rule out left atrial or appendage thrombi and anticoagulation are to be considered if feasible. Surgical procedures for atrial fibrillation are called Cox-Mace procedures in recognition of the pioneering work done by Cox and his colleagues. Initial work on AF from this group was left atrial isolation. Though this produced sinus rhythm in right atrium, left atrium continued to fibrillate and was a source for thromboembolism. In the initial Mace procedure, position of the sinus node was identified and atriotomies were made surrounding it on three sides to allow impulse propagation in only one direction. Additional incisions were made to direct impulses to all areas of the atrium while interrupting all possible macro reentrant circuits in the atrium. This prevented atrial fibrillation and restored atrioventricular synchrony. The first Mace procedure was done on 25th September 1987. Two important problems with Mace 1 procedure were chronotropic incompetence of the sinus node and occasional left atrial dysfunction. In Mace 2, the incision through the sinus node area in the high lateral right atrium was skipped. The transverse incision at the roof of the left atrium was moved posteriorly to permit better intra-atrial conduction. But Mace 2 had a problem in that it was necessary to transect the superior vena cava to expose the left atrium. In Mace 3, placing the septal incision posterior to the opening of the superior vena cava improved the exposure of the left atrium. Higher rates of sinus rhythm were achieved by Mace 3 procedure and they had improved long-term sinus node function. Atrial transport function was better and the need for pacemaker was lesser and so was arrhythmia recurrence. Later, it has been performed as a minimally invasive procedure with right submammary incision and even without cardiopulmonary bypass. Even in Mace 3, multiple atrial incisions were required, contributing to morbidity and complexity of the procedure. In 1990s, the first cryo-Mace procedures were performed with cryoablation replacing the surgical incisions with transmural ablation lines. The first non-cutensive Mace procedure with cryo was performed in 1999. In Mace 4, pulmonary veins are isolated bilaterally and a connecting lesion was also made. Since then, various energy sources like radio frequency, high frequency ultrasound, microwave and laser have been used for creating the ablation lines in Mace procedure. HAT score for prediction of atrial fibrillation. HAT score was developed for prediction of progression from paroxysmal to persistent atrial fibrillation. It checks the following parameters: heart failure, age, previous transient ischemic attack or stroke, chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, and hypertension. For the analysis, the authors included 1,219 patients with paroxysmal AF who participated in Euro-Heart survey on AF. Those who had progression of AF after 1 year of follow-up were noted. The components and weightage given in HAT score were as follows: hypertension 1, age 75 years or more 1, transient ischemic attack or stroke 2, chronic obstructive pulmonary disease 1, heart failure 2. In their study, 15% had progression of atrial fibrillation. It was noted that 50% of those with a score more than 5 progressed to persistent AF, while only 6% of those with score of 0 progressed. Those with progression of AF had more hospitalizations. They also had more major cardiovascular events. HAT score was used by Suneri and Associates to predict new onset atrial fibrillation using Taiwan National Health Insurance Research Database. Over a 2-year period spanning from January 1, 2000 to December 31, 2001, they enrolled 670,804 patients older than 20 years who had no history of cardiac arrhythmias. Huge majority of patients had HAT score of 0. 1.4% of patients had new onset atrial fibrillation during a mean follow-up period of 9 years. The occurrence of new onset atrial fibrillation was 0.8 per 1000 patient years at HAT score 0, while it was 57.3 per 1000 patient years with the HAT score of 7. Chen and colleagues used the HAT score to predict the occurrence of new onset AF after catheter ablation of typical atrial flutter. Of the 216 patients in their study, 39% experienced at least one episode of AF over a mean follow-up of 29.1 months. Using a cutoff score of 2, the group could be stratified into high-risk group with 69% occurrence of AF versus a lower-risk group with 27% occurrence of AF. Discussion on charge AF risk score to predict the risk of atrial fibrillation. The derivation cohort for the development of the charge AF risk score combined participants of three community-based studies from the United States of America. Framingham Heart Study, Cardiovascular Health Study, and Atherosclerosis Risk in Communities Study, or ERIC. The validation cohort comprised of two European studies, AEGIS study and the Rotterdam study. CHARGE AF risk score used multiple variables and gave them weightages. Age was taken per 5-year increment, height per 10 cm increment, weight per 15 kg increment, systolic blood pressure per 20 mm of mercury increment, and diastolic blood pressure per 10 mm of mercury increment. Other factors were smoking, use of antihypertensive medication, diabetes, heart failure, and myocardial infarction. Calculation of the actual CHARGE AF score is rather tough, as shown in this slide. The weightage coefficients were derived from the derivation cohorts. CHARGE AF score has been shown to predict AF better than CHARGE II VASC score. It may be noted that though CHARGE II VASC score was developed for prediction of stroke in atrial fibrillation, it has also been used to predict risk of atrial fibrillation. Discussion on APPLE, DR Flash, and MB Later scores for assessment of recurrence of atrial fibrillation after catheter ablation. DR Flash score is based on diabetes mellitus, renal dysfunction, persistent form of atrial fibrillation, left atrial diameter above 45 mm, age above 65 years, female sex, and hypertension. It was developed as a clinical score for left atrial arrhythmogenic substrate based on voltage analysis. Left atrial low voltage areas noted in patients with AF may predict recurrence after ablation, hence the need for this score. The probability for the presence of left atrial substrate requiring additional ablation other than the routine pulmonary vein isolation done for AF ablation increased by a factor of 2.2 with each extra point in the score. Risk of recurrence after pulmonary vein isolation for AF was 2 times higher in those with DR Flash score above 3. APPLE score is another one which has been developed to predict left atrial low voltage areas. 1 point each is given for age above 65 years, persistent AF, impaired eGFR below 60 ml per minute per 1.73 square meter body surface area, left atrial diameter of 43 mm or more, ejection fraction less than 50%. MB Later score is yet another one for prediction of very late recurrence of atrial fibrillation occurring more than 12 months after catheter ablation. Parameters assessed in the MB Later score were male, bundle branch block, left atrium 47 mm or more, type of AF, paroxysmal persistent or long-standing persistent, and ERIF, that is early recurrent atrial fibrillation. Paroxysmal AF was given 0 points, 1 point for persistent AF, and 2 points for long-standing persistent AF. All other parameters were assigned 1 point each. Maximum points possible were 6. Recurrences of AF within the 3-month blanking period after ablation were classified as early recurrence of AF. Cornet and colleagues compared APPLE, DR Flash, and MB Later scores to predict low voltage areas and arrhythmia recurrences in AF patients undergoing first catheter ablation. They calculated APPLE DR Flash scores at baseline and MB Later at 3 months after ablation in AF patients undergoing first catheter ablation. Though all scores were significantly associated with recurrences, early recurrent AF was the most powerful predictor of later rhythm outcomes. Hence, they concluded that a clinical score useful for prediction of both low voltage areas and rhythm outcomes in AF patients is a clinical unmet need.